Bonjour, Nijiwag. Miigwech bezendawiye inungum. Hello, my friends. Thank you for listening to me today. I am Katrina Phillips, and I am an assistant professor of history at McAllister College. I want to thank all of you for joining us today, and I also want to thank everyone at the Minnesota Historical Society who has helped make this series a reality. And so before we begin, I want to acknowledge that even though this is a virtual event, the Minnesota Historical Center is located on the traditional territory of many nations and on the homelands of the ancestral lands of the Dakota people, who still continue to call this region home. Minnesota is centered within Dakota creation stories, and it is an important place in traditional Ojibwe history and the history of other Native nations. We pay our respects to the Indigenous ancestors of this place. And this is the fourth event in an ongoing series called Shared Spaces and Public Places, which is a free four-part discussion series offered and archived on the MNHS Facebook and YouTube pages once a month. We've been doing this since July. And as the moderator for this series, I've been joined each month by scholars and artists and community members for a discussion about local as well as national issues. And our first session was a conversation about memory and monuments within Minnesota. And our second session turned to Confederate monuments and memory. Our third panel looked at historical erasure more broadly. And this final conversation brings together artists and curators to ask, how can our communities move forward to create public spaces that are more inclusive? And one of the things that's really kind of stood out to me throughout this entire series, and something that we'll be able to talk about more today, is truly that sense of community. And one thing that I've kind of been holding close to my heart is, you know, if you've seen images from early June when jingle dress dancers went down to the intersection of Chicago and 38th, where George Floyd was murdered. And it just kind of really gives you a sense of how these spaces become transformative and what they can do for those who experience them. And so now what we get to do, we'll just take some time to introduce you to the panelists that I have joining me today, and they'll just kind of give you a little bit of a background about their work, and then we'll get into our conversation. And so, Erin Genia, I'll start with you.
Thank you so much. My name is Erin Genia, and I'm a tribal member of the Sisseton Wahpeton Oyate. I live currently on the traditional Massachusetts territory in Medford, Massachusetts. And I'm just so excited to be here today with everybody. It really is an honor. And I've been engaged with this work about monuments, memory, community art, and history for a while now, and through various means. I'm a multimedia artist, working at the intersections of science and technology, civic arts practice, and Indigenous peoples' cultural fortification. In my work, I center Dakota philosophy and values, and I seek to amplify the powerful presence of Native people on the occupied lands of the United States of America. I also work as a culturally engaged community organizer, and I'm currently serving as an artist in residence for the city of Boston. So a bit about my background. I graduated last year from the Art, Culture, and Technology program at MIT, and I also have an MPA in tribal governance from the Evergreen State College. I've worked professionally in the field of Native arts and cultures and higher education while also maintaining my arts practice. So I guess one of the things I've been thinking a lot about lately, as we all have, is, you know, I've been grappling with how to address the, you know, white supremacy that we are all facing. And one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about is, you know, how what lies underneath that white supremacy is Western cultural supremacy. And as a Native person, I feel that so strongly, particularly in the field of art. And so, and I see it all over, you know, especially living in the Boston area. If you want to go back to that first slide, part of my residency, I organized this series of panels called Confronting Colonial Myths in Boston's Public Space. And this was a series of events that brought together Indigenous leaders, artists, and allies from the city who talked about their work in the public realm and addressed how public symbols perpetuating colonial myths affect their lives every day and contribute to this public health emergency of racism. So Boston is deeply colonial. You know, it's been a site of an epicenter of colonization of this continent. And it's a place where these myths really need to be addressed. So that's part of the work that I've been doing. The next slide there is, I also work with youth and I'm also a sound artist. And so in this particular image that what you see here is at the Urbano Project in Boston. And here I was working with youth artists to try to learn how we can acknowledge and respect our connections to the land we occupy, even in an urban space. And we can do that by respecting the native people of the place where we are and thinking about how the land supports us, even living in a city. So here you see some of my sound vessels, and these are clay sculptures that are built to transmit sound vibrations. And I work with sound as a media to express and kind of work with this life force that inheres in all objects, in what our dominant society today thinks of as inanimate really is not. So one more image that I have is a public art piece that I did called Ampa Owi Chakpi, Dakota Pride Banner. And this piece was installed at Seattle Center for about a year. And what it was a shout out to the urban native people living in the city of Seattle. And during the 1960s federal urban Indian relocation programs, the Seattle-Tacoma region was a place where a lot of Ocheti-Shakowin people came. And yet it was really rare to see any of our images or cultural cultural imagery in public space. And so I created this for my people in the city. So this work was really important to me because as I began working in the as a public artist, I started to think critically about sort of the utopian and Western settler colonial roots of this concept of public space. What that means, what that's all about, and trying to unpack that. And I've been doing that work since that time, mostly by writing and curating, organizing, and making public art. And I'm currently working on a collaborative project with the New England Foundation for the Arts Public Art Program called Centering Justice, Indigenous Artist Perspectives on Public Art. And this project consists of articles and interviews with Native artists, a symposium, and a collaborative public art piece. So that's just a bit about some of the work that I've been doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Erin. It's great to have you here with us today. And next, we'll hear a little bit about the work that Angela Two Stars has done and is still doing.
Hi, everybody. My name is Angela Two Stars. I am an enrolled member of the Sisseton Wahpeton Oyate. I was born and raised on the Lake Traverse Reservation. I'm currently living in St. Paul with my family. I am a public artist and also the director of All My Relations Arts, a project of the Native American Community Development Institute in Minneapolis. And my public art is, my one public one so far is at Bede Makaska. I incorporate Indigenous language into my art, specifically the Dakota language, as a means of highlighting the status of Native languages, the importance of them to our history and our identities as Native people. And Bede Makaska, the work actually connected me to my ancestral homelands here in Minnesota. Mach Piawi Chasta was my great, great, great grandfather. And so through this public art, I was able to connect with my past, with my history, and to be able to return home here to Minnesota, where I've been living for just over 2 years now. I have current works in development, five public artworks that are going to be opening up next year. I have a work with Winona State University, the Ordway Center for Performing Arts, the City of Minneapolis for the new public works building, St. Paul Port Authority through Forecast Public Art, and my largest one is the Walker Arts Center. I was selected as the finalist for the Indigenous Arts Commission to create a sculpture that will be in the Minneapolis Sculpture Garden. And those will all be debuting next year, 2021. So the project I'm doing with St. Paul Port Authority, I am extremely blessed to have Satu Jones as my mentor on that project. So that's wonderful to be able to learn from his wisdom and knowledge. Thank you all for having me today. I'm looking forward to our conversation.
Thank you, Angela. And so next up, I'd like to introduce you all to Satu Jones and just give him a little bit of space to introduce himself. And then we'll get to our last two panelists before we get into our conversation.
Hello, everyone. My name is Satu Jones, and I want to first give a big shout of thanks to Kate for attempting to try to wrap her arms around all of the artists on this panel. And big shout out to all the distinguished folks who are on this panel. I really am flattered and honored to be here with you all, sharing my ideas and visions. I describe myself as a visual artist. I create large-scale public artworks, but in addition to that, I've done work in theater. I have done work really on the land and landscape, and I've been fortunate and blessed to have made a mark here in the Twin Cities on the streetscape in ways to try and soften and embrace it and have folks have these pieces be a way to welcome folks into their communities. But I want to share with you a few images. This image here, many of you all may recognize it as George Floyd. This is a portrait that I did after the murder of George Floyd. Like many other artists, I was looking for a way to add my voice to the struggle to reform public safety and to really think about public safety in a new way. And so I created this portrait using several stencils, and it's on my website for folks to download for free. When University Avenues and Lake Street were covered with plywood, I and other folks bombed all of these images along Lake Street using just aerosol here. Next slide, please. This is an image of the Hiawatha Station, the U.S. Postal Office on 27th Avenue, just a few blocks away, actually just a block away from the 3rd Precinct. And unfortunately, it was burned. And so we see the remnants of that. But directly outside of the remnants of the old post office is an orchard that the community planted years ago. And even with the destruction, it was the fruit trees bloomed and bore fruit. Next slide, please. I harvested the fruit and made a pear tart, just to show the resilience that all of us have and all of us have to muster to, in order to overcome our current oppression and think of the ways that we can change the world.
Thank you, Setu, for taking the time to be with us today. This is, again, just like the other conversations, this is clearly going to be a great conversation, and we're so excited to have all of you with us today. And then the last two folks we have with us today are Todd Lawrence and Heather Shirey. So the two of you, we'd love to hear a little bit more about the work you're doing.
Thanks, great. I'll start us out. I'm Heather Shirey, and I am an art history professor at the University of St. Thomas. And I hope you didn't lose me there for a second. Along with Todd Lawrence, I'm part of the Urban Art Mapping research team. We're a multiracial, multigenerational, multidisciplinary group of faculty and students who are working together to document and analyze street art that's created in response to the murder of George Floyd. And it's really an honor for us to be on this panel alongside artists. I would say we're sort of accidental archivists, and we're documenting everything from small stickers and quickly written graffiti to large commissioned murals. Street art is really very ephemeral. Sometimes the graffiti that we're documenting is removed in just a matter of hours. Sometimes works stay up and become seen as iconic and are protected and preserved in the streets. And some of them are pieces on plywood that are removed and stored and might be in future exhibits in different contexts. But we think all this work is really important as nuanced expressions of this very complex movement and this moment in history. And we want to document all these voices and all these works over the course of time and on a global scale.
Hi, everybody. I'm Todd Lawrence. I teach African-American literature and culture, folklore, and cultural studies in the English department at the University of St. Thomas. And I, as Heather said, I work with her as one of the faculty directors of the Urban Art Mapping Project. And I think, as Heather said, one of the things that really, and if I could get the next slide would be great. One of the things that that made us want to start this project was that recognition that a lot of the art that was going up in the wake of the murder of George Floyd was art that would not last forever, and in fact would be taken down very quickly. And thinking about how people would look back and think about what had happened would be affected by the loss of that art. And so this piece right here is a good example. The sort of the bit on the right side of your screen, Don't Let Them Change the Narrative, I think expresses that notion that we really were thinking about. And this being on, you know, a piece of plywood, like all so many of the pieces were, the possibility of those things going away was actually really great. If I could go to the next slide. And these two pieces, I think, again, sort of demonstrate that these tags, this one on the left, which was at a gas station at the corner of Hamlin and a University Avenue, which is basically ground zero for the uprising in St. Paul. And then this tag, Mama, which was on the Walmart just about a block away from there. And both these pieces are now gone. And so we felt like it was really important to document this kind of art, as well as, you know, the sort of more established murals and things like that that have eventually become iconic and have been saved. But this kind of art, which we think it really expresses a lot of the feelings, the emotion, the reaction to what people had seen happen, the feelings that they had as they were in the streets in those moments after the uprising, I think were worthy of preservation. That's what one of the things that we want to do.
And if we can just go to the next slide. So one thing that really occurred to us as we started documenting art on a global scale and over the course of time is how some of these messages really become amplified, and maybe some nuance gets added to the messages over time. So this one is from later, it's from August, and this is from Portland. But that same very simple, very powerful graffiti that said Mama really becomes, I think, amplified in this work that thinks about how all mothers were summoned when he called to his mama. So documenting really lets us see how this develops over time.
And yeah, the next slide. So these are some pieces that were on Muddy Waters on Lyndale Avenue. And these pieces are gone now. And unfortunately, Muddy Waters is now out of business. But these are some of a few of our favorite pieces. And I think these pieces are really important because they speak directly, like a lot of the pieces do that are in our database, to directly to white supremacy and anti-blackness in a really direct and confrontational way. I think it's important to point out that, you know, we have right now about 1,500 records in the database, and there are more on backlog that we're trying to get in, and more pieces that people are, you know, other organizations and people who have images are trying to get to us. And also we still know that people have images on their phones that of images that they took of pieces, you know, months and months and months ago. We would like to have all those things, but we do have a wide variety of kinds of images, as Heather said, but a wide variety of images that show different kinds of sort of ideological positions, right? Like that are very much sort of, there's lots of anti-police stuff, there's lots of sort of politically oppositional stuff, but then there's a lot of stuff that, you know, sort of speaks to unity and working together, the kind of pieces that embody this sort of imagination, kind of like Setu was talking about, of a world that we want to live in, a world maybe where we don't need police, a world where everybody has enough food to eat, that sort of thing. So there's a sort of wide variety of that. And we don't distinguish between those different kinds of sort of ideological positions. It's all art, it's all important, and it all contributes to telling the whole story. So that's what's really important to us.
All right. So thanks to all of you for, you know, sharing some of your work with us and for, you know, letting our audience know a little bit more about all of you. And so I have just, you know, a couple questions that we can kind of start to have a conversation around, and we'll see where that takes us before we get to audience questions. And so Setu, I'm going to pose this question to you first, and then of course everyone else can share their thoughts as well. So what role has street art played in the movement for social justice?
Oh, you know, from the earliest days of Western civilization and civilizations throughout the world, you know, folks have raised their voices through art, whether it's graffiti on an Egyptian tomb, or whether it happened during the Spanish Civil War or during the American Civil War. Folks have used the street as a museum, as a way to express values, visions, ideas, opposition, the 99 theses on a door. I mean, on and on and on. And for me, that explosion in street art that happened in the late 60s and early 70s was what really inspired me. After the death of Martin Luther King. And then seeing the Wall of Respect in Chicago, in Old Bronzeville. My grandfather, who lived in Chicago, knew I wanted to be an artist and knew that I had to see this piece. So when I was 19 years old, I saw this mural that was created by a group of African-American painters, photographers, sculptors, musicians on the side of a storefront. And that was the way that folks were able to carry out the news, and by expressing those visions. And that just kind of blew my mind. And after seeing that, that was enough inspiration and information for me and other artists throughout the country to become a part of this big mural movement that happened in the 70s. So for me, you know, street art, and you know what, and then like, we're calling it street art now, but like 2,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago, folks didn't call it street art. I mean, that's just a handle that we have on it today. And not too long ago, folks were describing the mural movement as muralism. Now, that term came and went. In fact, I'm not sure how many folks on the panel here have even heard that term. It came and went so fast. And so street art may end up doing the same thing. It's one term for, as Todd and Heather are trying to point out, that encompasses so many different mediums, forms, sizes, I mean, on and on and on. So yeah, that's my thing on street art.
Yeah, if I could piggyback on that, I mean, one of the challenges we have is, like, it's so hard to define the category of what street art is. We find ourselves sort of like, is that street art? Is that street art? And it's a million different things, you know? So we have to draw the line somewhere, like, is chalk painting street art? Is that, you know? So I think it's such a large and capacious category, and people, you know, especially with regard to, you know, the movement, the contemporary movement, people tend to focus on the murals. And rightfully so. I mean, they're beautiful, they're striking, they're colorful, they're all of those things, but there's all this other stuff. I mean, the tags and the stickers and, you know, the throwies and, like, all this stuff that many people don't even consider to be art, right? They consider it to be vandalism. They consider it to be, you know, that's destruction, right?
That's right.
But it's expression. It's all expression, you know? And I think, you know, this, you know, art as a part of a movement. I mean, just about every important political movement has had artistic part of it, right? And I'm thinking, you know, I'm sort of a scholar of the Black Arts Movement that Tatum was just talking about. And, you know, I think it's Amir Baraka who said, you know, your art and your aesthetics are one, right? So the art is an expression of the aesthetic, of the ethics of a movement, not just the aesthetics of a movement, but the ethics of a movement. And so I think we're seeing that today in the art that's going up, you know, following the murder of George Floyd.
Sure, absolutely. I think so too.
And yeah, at some point in time, there will even be a term to describe this phase. You know, as Todd was saying, and I didn't really clarify this, you know, I was a part of the Black Arts Movement that was a cultural component to the Black Power Movement and to the Civil Rights Movement.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, along with what you're saying, Tatu, there will be maybe a new term, because what this is it's a conversation. It's a conversation that's done in visual form on walls. And it's a complex, nuanced conversation, because it's a really complicated, complex, nuanced movement, right? So there's anger, and there's fear, and there's hope. I mean, all these different emotions and responses, they become part of this conversation. And I think it can just play out on walls, and we're seeing that happening this many months later, and it's going to keep on going. And it's really, you know, powerful.
The last thing that I'm gonna add to this part of the discussion is that hopefully there will be scholars that, like Heather and like Todd, that have this empathy and sensitivity towards the movement that will help us define this and come up with a term. I mean, and not just scholars, you know, here again, just like that slide depicted, we have to tell our story. Maybe it is a poet from this time period that comes up with a term to describe this thing. I mean, you know, I don't think it was a scholar or an art critic, no offense, that came up with the term hip hop, you know, so we really need to come up with a way to describe this.
Well, and, you know, I think what you're all saying about the level of community engagement is also really important. You know, Todd and Heather, you're talking about where you get these images from, you know, if people are sending them to you from Portland, if they're sending them to you from all over the world, that idea of community and what it means to be a part of that. And so the next question I want to pose, and Angela, I'm gonna send this one your way to start. So why is work that engages the community important? Why do we need it? What does it do?
I think art has the ability to be the voice for the community, especially in public art that's accessible to the public. It's important to be able to work with the communities that are going to be impacted by the work that you create and to have their voices included, their stories included in the art that you're going to create. I've had, you know, every component of public art that I've been doing has included a level of community engagement in terms of B'day Mikaska work, talking with people that work in the language departments and language programs and making sure orthography is correct in sharing of the Dakota language at the lake. The piece I'm doing for the city of Minneapolis, it's the floor that I was assigned is actually the police floor. So it was an interesting community engagement component for me prior to the murder of George Floyd of interacting and engaging with the police for about a year leading up to this event. And then, you know, the emotions that I felt personally as an artist afterwards, you know, creating work for the specific community and then having kind of this explosion occur in Minneapolis and, you know, having to kind of reconcile within myself the art that I was creating. And also for me as an Indigenous artist, it's helpful and important to be able to share of my culture through public art. It's an invisible, you know, it's an often excluded and invisible group. And so I'm able to use through public art, that opportunity to share stories of the people that I'm representing within my culture.
I'll jump on there and say, you know, for us in our project, connecting with the community is really important because our project is a crowdsourced project. And, you know, I didn't speak, there were captions on the images that of the slides that we showed, but they're, you know, indebted to people like, I'm going to name Sally Pemberton, who is like our super documenter who for months went out every single day and took pictures of art everywhere in the Twin Cities. And she would tell us, you know, she's going to places where she'd never been in the cities before. So if it hadn't been for people in the streets, you know, when we first got the idea to do this, we knew that we couldn't document all the art, even in the Twin Cities, let alone around the world. Plus, we're in a pandemic, right? So it was people who were involved in the movement who were engaged with this art, who had seen it, who'd been moved by it, who sent this to us and made our project possible. And I think, you know, we think that this art is in so many ways an expression of the community and how the community feels. I mean, one of the biggest emotions that people were feeling was, you know, sadness and mourning, you know, and to collectively mourn, you know, a murder that everybody saw right in front of them happened right in front of them. It took the, you know, all the surfaces of the city to express all that intensity of emotion. That's the community speaking out. That's the community expressing itself. And as Heather said, you know, it's still continuing to happen. It's not over, you know, it's not over, not done with this yet, you know? So the community is really powerful. Those expressions are really, really powerful.
I would like to add a thought or two on that too, just and really want to hold up Angela and Todd, what you said. I guess I also think of what does it mean, and also say to what you were saying about what is art, you know, how are we defining art? How do we define it in this sort of Western art trajectory? You know, there's all these classifications and hierarchies around fine art or craft or all kind of like, how do these things like really reflect what people are doing and what is needed in our culture? And so I always think about, well, how is art serving us? What is it doing to serve us? Is it allowing us to be critical? Is it allowing us to pass along skills and knowledge? Is it allowing us to express ourselves? And so I think that, you know, this conversation is really important because we can begin to think about how art can truly, you know, as a basis for what we are as humans, how can it help move us forward? And that is essential. It's essential to have our communities be a part of that process.
Well, and Aaron, you know, to just kind of keep this thought rolling a little bit, you know, we've talked about community engagements, and I love your point about, you know, what is art, right? And all of the different forms that art can take, whether it's in a gallery, whether it's on plywood, whether it's, you know, in a big city or in a small town. And so, you know, I think there are a lot of questions around that. But another thing that's kind of been at the forefront in a lot of these conversations are, you know, these other forms of art, like monuments and things like that. And so the question that I want to send your way first before, you know, inviting our other panelists to talk about it as well. So, you know, there's a lot of contestations over monuments right now, but, you know, on one hand, I guess, why monuments? And, you know, what other ways could we recognize or acknowledge things that are important to us? And how do we determine what those things are?
Thank you, Katie. Yes, I think that's such an essential question right now. I mean, for me, when I boil it down, monuments represent a society's collectively held values and philosophies and the people and events of significance to that society. And what does that mean in our settler colonial society? You know, who are we honoring? You know, when only a specific type of person is worthy of honoring, it sends a really strong message to everyone else. Honoring slavery, honoring genocide, honoring colonization, you know, it creates a hostile environment in public space, and it contributes to racism as a public health emergency. And I do believe that monuments have that power. But I also, you know, I agree with you. I want to think critically about monumentality. What does it mean in terms of permanence to have something, you know, that is meant to stay there in a specific site in perpetuity? You know, what does that mean for our society as a society that evolves and changes and grows? You know, I feel like that many of the monuments that are present in our public spaces do honor this hierarchical way of looking at the world. These individuals who, you know, have done something, and really that's, to me, problematic. And, you know, I think that it also contributes to Western cultural supremacy too, you know, which has been such a harmful force across the world and over history. And, you know, I'm really glad that we're having these conversations, that monuments are giving us a focal point to talk about these issues. You know, I guess a question that I have is, at the same time, why do we place so much significance on a monument itself and put so much into it? And yet at the same time, you know, we desecrate the land that monument is on, or we disrespect the people who and communities of that site. You know, one final thought that I was thinking too, and just thinking about this issue and our conversation here, because I've been involved with advocating for, you know, confronting these colonial myths in Boston's public art. And I've been participating in some art commission meetings, public meetings. And at the last meeting, you know, we were discussing what would happen with this Christopher Columbus statue that had been beheaded. And there were folks who were advocating for putting the statue back. And I shouldn't be surprised, but it was shocking. One of the people who was in favor of putting the statue back called the people who had knocked off the head terrorists. And so, you know, so I think that it really points to this divide of what are our values and you know, how can we, I don't know, I guess, you know, I'm really, it's upsetting that we're so divided in this country. And yeah, so I guess I just, you know, want to continue to talk about these issues, and I really appreciate the opportunity to do that here. Thank you.
Yeah, I think Erin gave us an awful lot to think about in her comments. I mean, and I was thinking that, you know, monuments tend to be these sort of, like you said, these large sort of permanent, you know, kind of fixtures, but they're usually, you know, put up by people in power and by people with money and resources, right? And then the ideals or the ideas that those monuments support are supposed to be everybody's, right? And that's kind of the problem, is that, you know, as society changes, or maybe even in the beginning, like when a lot of those monuments went up in the South, for example, those monuments to Confederate generals and things like that, there was actually more people who, you know, because there's more Black people in some counties than there were white people, and they still had monuments up to Confederate soldiers, right? So that wasn't really expressing the ideals of the majority of the people, right? So, I mean, I guess one of the things that really sort of struck me when I saw all that art go up in the streets here in the Twin Cities was, you know, somebody asked me this, you know, about the image of George Floyd's face. Like, to me, there's like 100,000 monuments to George Floyd all over this city, all over this country. Whenever I see his face, when I see that stencil that Saytu has made available to everyone, and made it so that everyone can put up a monument to George Floyd if they want to. All you need is a can of spray paint, right? You know, and if there are that many monuments to George Floyd, can nobody take it down, right? Like, you can't erase it. Nobody's going to be able to erase that image of that man's face. And when we see it, we remember what happened, and no one's going to be able to take that away, right? You know, so I think there's a way in which there's more power in the kind of you know, recognizing representation, I guess, you know, in the public space, and the way that, you know, artists, grassroots artists are doing, then even, you know, I don't know if anybody's asked, like, can we put up a giant statue of George Floyd somewhere? I mean, maybe at this, you know, the memorial site or something, that might happen. But I think it's more powerful to have his face everywhere on the streets, you know?
Absolutely. Two little quick stories. One is, I was a skinny kid with a big mouth and growing up. And so, you know, there were a couple bullies that were after me from time to time. And I knew the route to go home from school to avoid them, you know, but yeah. And it's just like, so that's one story. The other story is, my father owned a liquor store in South Minneapolis, where I grew up. I was born in North Minneapolis, grew up in South Minneapolis. My family has been in Minnesota for four generations, since the 1870s. My father's liquor store, I worked there, and every Friday this man would come in, this brother would have us fill out his check, because he had a hard time writing. But every time you would ask him, say, "Hey man, what's up?" His answer every Friday, every month, throughout the year, was, when we said, "Hey man, what's up? White man still on top." And so that's the way I feel when I see those things that are described as monuments. I feel like I'm being bullied. You know, I don't want to go past those things because of what they represent. And it's still, most of them are still the white man on top. Now, if you look at the work that Erin is doing, that Angela is doing, it's work that isn't even the same style and form as these pieces take. These pieces are relics from another point in history, when folks unabashedly would place themselves in these positions of white, actually, I say that like it's long gone, white supremacy, those positions of power, but it's something that still exists now. And those things that are described as monuments are ways to remind us all the time who is still on top.
Well, and I think, you know, I think you're all really speaking to a lot of the questions that have come up throughout these conversations that we've been having throughout all of our panels, right? And, you know, Aaron, you used a word that really struck me when you talked about like the monumentality, right? Because I feel like we can interpret that in a couple different ways, right? Whether it's this, you know, the supposed permanence of these monuments. And, you know, Todd, your point as to where a lot of these monuments went up, right? And I mean, that it's not a coincidence, right? Like you can say that it was very deliberate, right? Because what's going to be a better show of power than this giant statue?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you go to down in the South and at every courthouse and every little county in Mississippi, there's a, you know, a kind of obelisk out in front of it for that's a monument to the heroes of the Civil War and not the North. They're not talking about the North, right? So if you are a Black person coming to that courthouse seeking to get justice, well, you know, as soon as you get to the door that you ain't gonna get justice, right? If that's what that signals to you, you know? And so, I mean, I think it's really, you know, another aspect of this and all the artists here on this panel, I think their work is contributing towards this is to change the way that people experience space. You know, like Setu was saying, I mean, the thing about a monument is, you know, the permanence. And then that word also suggests the bigness of it, right? Like you feel like it's bearing down upon you, that it's oppressing you. But one of the things that I felt, and I'm talking, you know, specifically about the art, you know, in the streets after the uprising, because that's what I'm most familiar with, that there are other kinds of art that contribute to this. But one of the things that I felt walking down University Avenue on Friday morning, after there had been all this unrest and fires and everything, but there was art everywhere. And it was like the space was transformed, that it was different, that people had said, no, this is our space. We're going to decide what it looks like. And I realized, you know, there are gonna be people who say, well, that was my store and that was this and that, you know, this damage or whatever. I understand that, but I'm talking about the sort of overall feeling as a person of color, as, you know, a member of the BIPOC community, walking through that space, a space that didn't always feel like it was my space, didn't always feel like it was safe, didn't always feel like it was embracing me. Now it had pictures of people who looked like me, you know, drawings everywhere. It had expressions of the kind of feelings that I had, pain, anger. It was embracing me, you know. So I think, you know, the art that all three of these artists are doing really helps do that, because it's in public spaces, because it's on the street, because it's in a park or wherever, you know, it is, that I'm going to encounter it in where formerly it would have been, you know, some big statue of, like, I don't know, some white person. And now it's not. That changes the way that I feel in that space. And I think that's really an amazing thing.
So I have one more question, but I just want to, you know, remind the folks who are watching or listening that, you know, we'll definitely have time for our panelists to answer any questions you might have. So if you're on Facebook, you can just, you know, drop them in a comment down below. We've got folks behind the scenes who are going to work to pull all of those together. So again, feel free to ask your questions and we'll get to them very shortly. But the last question I have, and this one is kind of going to be directed toward Todd and Heather first, but why do we need to archive street art, and why are these public spaces important?
I have so many thoughts about that.
Let me say something real quick before you. I'm going to jump in. You know, they are performing this valuable service. But, I mean, we're doing this under the auspices of the Minnesota Historical Society. The Historical Society should be doing this. This time needs to be recorded. And so the Historical Society needs to get on the case here.
I think that's so true, that the time needs to be recorded. And then also, like, the feeling needs to be recorded. Like what Todd said earlier about walking down University Avenue and feeling like that space belonged to him in a new way. That's so powerful. And lots of people have felt like that, seeing all this art. And so I think it's important to document it, to just record that moment and that feeling, like that really powerful feeling. And it's really ephemeral, it's fleeting. I think when people are painting on plywood with spray paint, they probably know it's not necessarily going to last. And then the work that's the most counter-institutional and the most likely to challenge the structures of society, like the anti-cop messages, that is the stuff that is the most fleeting, and it disappears really quickly. And we've noticed that, like we've seen things really be buffed very quickly or taken down or painted over with other messages that kind of change the narrative a little bit. And I think the important thing is that that narrative not just be changed over time so that in 10 years we look back and see this nice, neat package of what happened in 2020 and it started and then it ended, because it's not like that. It's messy and it's complicated and it's ongoing and it's going to keep going. And, you know, I think documenting it lets us see that there's a kind of momentum and a power, and there are moments that might get quieter and there are moments that get louder again. So I think that's a really powerful reason to document it. And then I think, like I said in the beginning, I think we're kind of accidental archivists. We don't really actually know totally what we're doing in terms of archiving things, and we just are learning a lot about metadata. So sure, Minnesota Historical Society should get on that with us too and partner with us as well. But I think also we're really coming to think about how the archive can be an activist force itself. It's not just a passive repository of information and images, but the archive, we hope, will keep doing things like keep those messages alive, keep that conversation going, and that the archive itself can be a force to help fight white supremacism and promote anti-racist society in the future.
Yeah, I think if I could just add to that, another reason why it's important to, you know, archive this material is because, you know, again, we've said many times about the sort of fleeting nature of art in the streets. We think of this archive as a place where people can that people can use for educational purposes and research purposes. And so we hope that, you know, students will come and look at the site, and, you know, sort of we're trying to think of different ways that we can make the art that's in the archive more accessible to people. I mean, there's so much now that if you sat down and started like sort of flipping through it one image at a time, it would take a lot of time. We try to create some sort of exhibits, kind of ways of putting art together so people can kind of see a little bit at a time. But I think the other thing is we have a mapping element to this archive as well. And so we're on the research side, I mean, that's a really big part of what we're doing too, is trying to think about why was this art in this particular place and what kinds of art. So, you know, we've seen pretty clearly that art that was close to the center of the uprising, either in St. Paul or Minneapolis, was more politically oppositional. And then the further you get away from those sort of points on the map, the art gets sort of more about community and collaboration and peace and things like that, right? So we get, in a way, using the art, you can kind of map the emotions that people were expressing in this movement, you know? So, I mean, things like that would not be easy to do unless we were collecting as much of this art as possible. So there's stuff that people will figure out how to do with this art in the future, with this archive, that we haven't thought about yet. And that's just one way, you know, that's the way that we've thought, oh, let's put it on a map and see what this actually looks like in space. Somebody else is going to think of something and figure something out and take that information and the metadata and do something really cool with it, and really something that will reveal something that we didn't think about and nobody saw it yet. So that's an important reason to archive it as well.
Well, and I think it's also really crucial that we think about what all of you are talking about as far as reclaiming the space, right? And, you know, Angela, you kind of referenced this a little bit earlier, but can you tell us a little bit more about the Walker? You know, if you think about what's happened there over the past couple of years, how do you see the work that you get to do as a way to reclaim that space?
It's impactful. I tell you, you know, it was a big deal for me to get that opportunity, but then to know it came out of this controversy that was scaffolded, and initially not wanting to be associated with it at all. It was only through my process of my community engagement, working with elders and speakers, because I see my work as a conduit of the work that they're doing. And so to see their reactions to the project I was developing, to see how impactful it was to them, made me realize, like, I need to be in a different spot. I need to reclaim that space that the scaffold was at, because rather than trying to avoid the elephant in the room, I'm going to take over the narrative of what came out of that. And this is going to be about my work, not the scaffold. And this is going to be about the beauty that is the work that I'm creating, that's telling this larger story of Dakota language. And it's going to be a place of healing. It's going to heal the land. And it's also going to be healing people that were traumatized by, you know, that sculpture. And so for me, that's what's so impactful about being able to reclaim the space and reclaim the narrative. And, you know, I'm able to do that in other works that I'm doing. You know, at the Ordway, I'm doing a visual land acknowledgement. And so, like, right underneath the Ordway sign, there's going to be a visual land acknowledgement that's, like, you know, an impact from the Ordway saying, this is how we stand behind our commitment to acknowledging, you know, Dakota people, the land that we're on, and, you know, furthering this commitment. So it's holding people accountable. It's really holding these institutions accountable for the land that they're on, how they got the land. And I think it's also being able to share, you know, the larger story of the Indigenous people, you know, who occupied the space prior to, and that we are still here. We're still, you know, knowledgeable and present and strong and resilient. And I'm able to do that through my work. And so it's really impactful and powerful for me to be able to have that opportunity to do send that message in public art.
So we
keep
have
making us proud.
So we have just a couple more minutes before we get into the audience questions. And so, you know, with this idea of reclaiming space, I'm just thinking about, you know, all of the different spaces that you all work in, and, you know, again, to kind of reference the Portland image. But then I also kind of want to tie that back to the work that Aaron does, because one of the images that you showed was from Seattle. And, you know, a lot of the work that you've been doing more recently is more on the East Coast. So how do you tie all of those ideas together when you're working in a different place like that? Because, I mean, your work is kind of, I mean, across the entire country by this point, if you think about it.
Thank you, Katie. Yes, I guess Dakota values and philosophies are portable. Part of those values is honoring the original people of whatever land that I find myself on. And I truly believe that is something that everybody must do, you know, that we all of us have to think about that and center that and honor those people. So, you know, and a lot of my experience is also about being an urban Native person too, because my family left the reservation, and I grew up mostly in the New York area. And so, you know, so I think a lot about that, and I think about, you know, connections. What does that mean? Connections to culture when, you know, when, because of this history, you know, this very long history of dispossession and this diaspora that we're living in. And yet at the same time, we can, as I said, you know, we can still do our work. We can still maintain our cultural connections, and we can maintain our connections to community and family and our obligations and our responsibilities to future generations. So that's just, you know, kind of how I approach my work. And there's a lot of work that needs to be done in those areas, particularly in cities where people are very disconnected from, you know, the water that supports their physical bodies, the air that they breathe, the land that they're on. It's people are very disconnected. This is a time of alienation. You know, we need to be thinking about these issues even more and being critical about how we got here, you know, the our colonial past and how that has impacted every place in this country and in so many places across the world too. We're in this boat together, I guess. I've been, you know, thinking about how art and the creative practice, you know, really sort of like a creative inquiry can be a force for addressing some of those issues, those problems. And, you know, working in this current residency with the city of Boston, I'm working with the Department of Emergency Management and trying to consider how to think about culture and to think about, you know, how we can change our ways of doing things to address emergency situations, for example, racism. How can we address that at a cultural level? What can artists do? What can cultural practitioners do? Culture bearers, you know? And so I'm just very interested in uplifting the people who are doing that work too. As an artist, I feel like that my work is strengthened when everybody who wants to present their own visions on these issues can do so. And so to me, it's important that that I contribute to that in some way.
All right, well, I am, thank you all for again, taking the time to be here. So now we'll kind of switch gears a little bit and we'll start pulling in some questions that we've been getting from the audience. And so Harrison Deckard, I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly, asks, I'm curious about each artist or historian's take on civil activists or protesters pulling down or defacing public art. Is there ever a justification for destroying public art as a political statement? And we'll just open the floor for that one.
Well, that's a tough question. So I'll wade into the breach on it. I mean, obviously, people feel differently about art being defaced depending upon if they feel like that art is theirs, right? So, and I can even speak of myself personally, right? Like, did I feel a great deal of, you know, horror at a Christopher Columbus statue being defaced or beheaded or something? Not really. I mean, that Robert E. Lee statue in Richmond, Virginia, that got tagged all up, I was kind of like, that's cool. I kind of like that, right? But at the same time, whenever, you know, street art that kind of expresses my point of view and my feelings, when that's defaced, I feel some pain and sadness. So, I mean, I guess maybe one way to think about it is that, you know, public space is a kind of contested space, and the expression that's made there is sort of open for response. I think, like Heather said earlier in the conversation, this is a conversation. Like, artistic expression, especially in public space, is a conversation. I wish there were rules to it, but there are kind of not so many rules, and people kind of express themselves in whatever ways that they want to, and people respond to that expression in different ways as well. So, I mean, I think they can make as many laws as they want to about, you know, let's say defacing, you know, a public monument or something like that. It's not going to stop people from doing it if they feel compelled to do it. And, you know, you can't protect every piece of art. You can't have, you know, guards standing there to protect it. So I guess I'm kind of weaseling out of this by saying art is part of a conversation, and especially that art in public spaces is just like the response that you get is the response that you get. And I think artists know that. I mean, I'm not an artist. We should have one of the artists speak to this. Like, I don't know if any of y'all have ever had your piece defaced or something like that, and how that felt, and, you know, what you thought about that.
I see Setu nodding his head.
Yeah, I was going to ask Angela or Aaron if any of their work has ever been tagged. You know, there, once again, you know, as we were trying to describe what art is, you know, different folks have had different ways of communicating. you know, during the hip hop revolution, where graffiti writers were tagging and creating work, you know, throughout the world, one of the ways to show respect is by not doing anything to that piece. One of the ways to show disrespect is by tagging a piece. And many times I would create this dialogue that would happen back and forth as one artist added something, another artist added something else to that particular piece. You know, I've had work that has been tagged. I even had a piece one time that I created this overlook in a park in North Minneapolis during the height of the crack epidemic that hit. And I had no idea. We did this community engagement process in creating that piece, but I had no idea that we left out some of the folks that ruled that park at night. And so there was a gang squabble, and my piece was burned to the ground and not replaced. You know, I've had pieces now. Sometimes a piece is removed and it's done in all the ways that in our capitalist society is are termed legal. You know, a developer buys another building or something happens and there's a new piece put there on the site where this artwork existed. You know, and so yeah, it does sometimes bother me when a piece of mine has been tagged, but that is another way of expressing this work. I mean, this is, I think that we need, as Aaron was saying, another way of examining issues like this, continuing this discussion, maybe even reviewing work after 40 or 50 years, you know, does it still need to be there? There was an article in Mempost just this morning asking that question or proposing that. Maybe every 40 years we need to review this work. But one of the things that the destruction of Christopher Columbus showed Minnesota is that we had no process for looking at and evaluating public art over time. You know, is that piece still a piece that should be there? I mean, should we should even look, really be reviewing the state seal, Minnesota state seal, really looking at that and questioning it. You know, we need to have that kind of process.
I would like to discuss or comment on how the kind of the differences between monuments versus, you know, the public art processes that I've gone through and, you know, monuments that are just created for an individual rather than, you know, an actual process, application, jury, like all these things that I have to go through and contemplate and consider when I'm creating a piece of work. And part of that is knowing that vandalism is a component, a potential hazard of the public art, and also time. When I was meeting with a conservator about my language work at Bidet Makoska, I couldn't give them an answer for 50 years. Like if this piece is cracked, you know, 50 years from now, do you want it exactly the same? And I said, I don't know, because I don't know if that's still going to be how we say Tatanka, you know, when we're talking about a buffalo, because, you know, when I was a kid, Shunka Wakan is how you said horse, and now it's said Shuwaka. So because the language is alive, it changes. And so the language might not be the same in 50 years. So I can't say, yeah, 50 years this is going to be exactly the way this, you know, word is going to be used. So I was like, it kept probably frustrating for them, but I was like, well, that's the nature of time and public art.
All right, so we've got another question that just popped up. Molly McIntosh asked, how does street art represent / embody the process of healing in the face of public trauma?
Well, I can start, but I also want to toss that question out to all the artists that are involved here too, because I'm really just looking at and documenting work. But I feel like in this street, we can see just so many different responses and emotions play out. And it's a place where that can happen, you know, and it is a place where all of these responses can be reevaluated really quickly. And I think this ties into the previous question too. It kind of takes the sort of preciousness and the timelessness away from what we think of art and allows for it to be like about a process of creating and recreating and responding. And I think that's really important when we're thinking about healing and how it operates through the visual format of art. But I, like I said, I would love to hear what this process is like also for artists, because when we've interviewed artists, a lot of artists have talked to us about how the act of producing work, how the act of maybe making an image that honors George Floyd or Breonna Taylor, or that envisions a new future, how that is itself a kind of powerful form of healing. But I'd love to have other people talk to that.
I can share. I think that art is cathartic, and I think that art. Oh, I'm talking over to you.
Hard questions.
I just but, really quickly that this... maybe I won't. Which one's gonna go? I think. Can I finish?
I think so. Yeah.
No, what was I gonna say? No. You know the. Art is cathartic, and the visual art has a way of being able to express these visceral feelings that people were going through after, you know, the uprising. And art was able to express things that words sometimes cannot. And I think people could connect to that inability to put into words how they were feeling through the art that they were seeing. Okay, now I'm done. C2 can go.
Yeah, I'm sorry, we're having some, it looks like some bandwidth issues here, but art, you know, it's almost cliche to say that it's healing. Stories and these narratives are so powerful and are healing for me to be able to repeat this image of George Floyd over and over again. His portrait is like when folks chant, say his name. And it's, and for me, now I create this work that I think is altruistic. I create this work that I hope adds information and inspiration, but also this work almost very selfishly is about me. And I create this work because out of this passion and this love I have for myself, for my family, for my community, and for the world. It's this, and all of that is expressed in the work that I create personally. And you can see that in the work of all the artists who are creating this work. If for nobody else, for nobody else but the artists, the process of creating this work is helps heal.
I was also thinking about how public art can also be healing in a sense of relationship to a particular site, to the land itself. It can help us to begin to think of that place for what it is, for the, you know, the qualities of that land and you know, that particular maybe body of water or geological formation. To me, those are art as well. I mean, those are the true monuments there. Those are the things that we need to be upholding. Because those are, you know, those are the things that are giving us life. And so I think that art can really help to reorient people to those things. You know, when I think about some art, some public art, or in particular monuments, really are about dominating a particular spot. Art that is thoughtfully done by artists themselves and is very much, can very much be about that individual process, as Setu has said, can help to open up sites in that way and provide for sort of a collective experience around a particular site.
Yeah, maybe if I think that was really powerful comment, and it's not the same thing, but it made me think about, you know, the memorial site at 38th in Chicago, and how that site is really what it is because of all of the art that's there, right? I mean, people bring flowers and art, like all kinds of sort of visual expressions of their grief, of their pain, of their, you know, of memorializing not just George Floyd, but other people who've been killed. And it just is kind of amazing how powerful it is. It's not a street anymore. It's not an intersection anymore. And I know there's a lot of talk about what's going to happen to that area in the future. But I think that, you know, one of the reasons people feel so strongly about it is not just because it's the site where something happened, but it has been the site where people are processing what happened and dealing with what happened and responding to what happened. And, you know, sort of putting together their ideas about how to move forward. So it's become something else entirely. So anybody who's thinking about that as a street or as an intersection is thinking about it wrong right now, right? Like, that's not what it is anymore. And art has contributed to transforming that into another place. So everybody who goes there now has a different experience with that location than they had before, when it was just an intersection with the store on the corner, whatever. It's not that anymore. It's changed. It's different entirely.
All right, so we have another question. This one's from Janine Marie, who asks, how can people best support public art and help direct resources to artists and projects that center BIPOC voices and experiences? And then in parentheses, there's another question that says, who do we call at MNHS to make sure this archiving project gets funded?
I guess I can jump in on that one. That's a question that I've been thinking a lot about lately too, in some of the work that I've been doing, particularly with the Centering Justice Project, and trying to, I guess, marshal resources to figure out how we can get more Native artists in particular to be doing public art. And I think there's a lot of challenges around that. You know, there's anything from the logistical technical side of it, of getting your, you know, having the understanding the process of how to go through the proposal and contracting process, to, you know, providing support for artists as they kind of navigate, you know, working with various different entities to make their art happen. And I think that the effort just needs to be put into that, and a place needs to be made for that specifically, and reaching out to the artists who have this interest to find out what it is they need is really important. And one of the artists that I was working with, some of this has said that highlighted the need for building relationships. What is it that your organization is doing to build relationships with people in those communities? And not just like a one-off, you know, here's some funding and go do your thing, but what does it mean to actually develop a relationship with that person, to make sure that person can continue to do their work, continue to impact their community? And, you know, so I think that to me, that was really brilliant. And I think that should be taken to heart when we consider this question.
Just to speak a little bit to the situation locally with street art that's emerged in the aftermath of the murder of George Floyd. For us, we knew from the beginning that we were always going to create just digital documentation, and that our group was not going to physically try to preserve or in the future exhibit works of art on plywood. But there are lots of organizations in the Twin Cities who are doing that work of collecting and preserving those boards, which is a huge project to take on. And I personally think it's great that there are lots of different institutions, and especially not institutions, individuals, and especially BIPOC groups and individuals who are really taking charge of that process. And we've been in communication a lot with Save the Boards and Memorialize the Movement, who I think are doing really good work. But there are lots of, like I said, lots of people who are doing this. And I think that's important, that it's not centered with one institution. It's not Minnesota Historical Society. It's not MIA. It's not one institution that's really in charge of collecting. I think there are choices in terms of what is collected and what is preserved. There are choices about what will happen with those physical objects in the future. And I personally am happy to see that those choices are made by many different individuals and made by many individuals in the BIPOC community. And I hope that that continues and that people will support lots of different people doing that work and not feel like it should just be big institutions doing it, if that makes sense.
I think I'm going to say also like creating a safe space for artists to create within like these institutions that where we're creating works that are sensitive to our culture, to be able to navigate these institutions and organizations and to be able to create work, to have it come to fruition in spaces where we are one of. And to be able to have a space where we feel safe, that I think for me is really important.
All right, we have time for one or hopefully two more questions. We'll see how quickly we can get through these. So if we can bring up another one. So this question asks, can monuments be modified by artists and activists to create a new narrative?
Yes.
Yeah, I agree. Like, I think, you know, that monument in Richmond was one of the most powerful things I've ever seen. And with the projection on it and everything, like at night when they had it with the project, I mean, that was just amazing. And, you know, for people who wanted to, you know, clean it up or whatever, like, nah, I just thought that was, it was wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, I think that these monuments or these sculptures or whatever we want to call these things can be retuned. I mean, even thinking about the beheading of the Christopher Columbus piece, maybe that piece should come down and be replaced with the image of George Floyd, or maybe even put my head on Christopher Columbus's body. But we need to think about this in ways as transformers, as tricksters, as lovers of ourselves and society. We need to reimagine another public landscape.
All right, so with our last question here, the question is, when does destruction of public art become censorship?
I had a piece of work. Actually, the piece, the Dakota Pride banner, I don't know if we can pull that one up again in terms of the image, but the piece itself was, one of the inspirations for that piece was the Pride banner that the LGBTQ community has used. And it's about diversity, and it's about the diversity of our communities and many different kinds of people, you know, coming together for common cause. But the banner was actually, it was torn down a couple of times, and it did have one time somebody had thrown a drink at it, and like a soda or pop can. And so it was always put back up. And of course, you know, I don't know if it was maybe because of anti-Indian sentiment, which is of course, you know, something that we always have to deal with in public space, or whether that, you know, whether it was anti-LGBTQ sentiment, or maybe it was just, you know, people fooling around and jumping on it or whatever. I think that in when a piece is in public space, you always have to sort of consider the different layers of, you know, people who are interacting with it. And I don't know that I would consider that to be censorship, but, you know, that was something that I didn't really, I guess I wasn't really prepared for when I made the piece, because when you have a studio practice and you're making work maybe just for museums, it's a little bit different. It's like, okay, I'm going to make this piece and it's going to go on the wall somewhere or in a collection. It's going to be respected. But when something is out in public, it becomes a focal point for, you know, people to interact with in whatever way they, I guess, see fit. And so, yeah, so that's an experience that I had.
I think, you know, it's such a difficult question. I mean, it goes back to, you know, our thoughts earlier about, you know, art in the streets being a conversation, being part of an exchange. And, you know, it tends to be, this is sort of me spitballing a little bit, but it tends in my mind, in my observation, it tends to be the pieces that get, destroyed or pulled down or whatever, it tends to be those ones that are upholding this sort of dominant ideological kind of, you know, idea about our country, you know, or about a particular group of people or about one individual person, as opposed to, you know, the other, like, you don't see so much up in arms, sort of people up in arms whenever, you know, somebody defaces a mural, you know, and which has happened a couple of times at the site, the George Floyd Memorial site, for example. It's in the papers, but nobody's talking about, let's make a law to, you know, make sure that people can't do that or something. It's not, you don't see the same kind of backlash against it, I guess. And I think when Aaron was talking, I don't know if this is me saying this, and I don't know if others would feel the same way. I used to hear people when I first moved up to the Twin Cities about 20 years ago, I used to hear people say, you know, like, the racism up here is kind of different. And I kind of liked it back down south, where at least you knew where you stood. People would always say that to me. And I kind of feel like if people are going to come out and do this kind of expression, like whether it's, you know, defacing peace or whatever, well, at least I know where I stand. At least I know what you think. And we had the opportunity then to respond to what it is that you're doing. Like, people not just gonna be passive when something like this happens. And I think the most productive way is to make more art, you know, and people can't tear down everything, you know, and you know, maybe the problem for people who want to put up, Christopher Columbus statues is like, nobody really wants to put up that many more Christopher Columbus statues because it's not interesting anymore. You know, like the Christopher Columbus statue with Satu's head on it would be way more interesting than another Christopher Columbus statue, you know, in my opinion. So, I mean, that's I think that really is the thing, is that people are just going to respond to it. And you show me where you stand, I'm going to show you where I stand. And, you know, I say that as not an artist, but as a person who loves what artists do. So
I want to be mindful of our time here, but in closing, I just want to say, you know, to say thank you so much to all of you for being here. Thank you, Angela and Aaron and Satu and Todd and Heather. I want to say, you know, thank you to all of the folks behind the scenes at MNHS who have made this all look so incredibly easy for us to just kind of get to hang out here and talk. We literally could not do this without them, and I want to make sure that they get the recognition that they so rightly deserve. And I want to thank, you know, everyone who's joined us, whether you're on Facebook or YouTube, whether you're watching us live or whether, you know, you're watching us after the fact. You know, it's been really incredible to have the chance to moderate all of these conversations and to get a chance to talk with, you know, scholars and activists and artists. And, you know, I just want to thank MNHS as well, right? Because, you know, they're really difficult conversations to have. And, you know, they've been so willing and open to bringing all of these people together. And, you know, as a historian by trade, you know, you know, history is not objective. And so I think all of the things we're saying here, whether we're talking about what it means to be Indigenous in Minnesota, or what it means to talk about Confederate monuments and memorials, historical erasure and community art and activism, I think is just, it's really powerful. And in closing, I will just say miigwech. Thank you all very much. And hopefully we'll see you again soon.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.